Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Sorry.
Let us continue. Before I continue with the remaining ZCPs, as respond to the last question that based on the my humble studies for the last decade, I have gone through many literatures, many kitab written by various ulama, and I have gone through various hadith, and the most interesting thing that I found is that there is no single evidence in which a sahaba, a companion, pays zakat directly to the recipient, to the mustahik. There is no single evidence, except for the case of infaq and sadaqah. Zakat is always paid through amil. That's why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has appointed 25 companions as the amil officers. For example, Ibn Lutaybah from Bani Asad, Mu'adh bin Jabal, Ali bin Abi Talib, etc. So there are 25, according to my humble studies. I've listed there are 25 companions or sahaba that were appointed as amil officers by the president at that time, that is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it means that this should be the spirit why the presence of amil is very important, why amil is mentioned clearly by Allah in the Quran. It must have reasons, it must have deep thinking, it must have rational why Allah put amil there. So what we are trying to do is, let us try to educate the people that donating zakat should be through institution of amil, instead of you pay directly to the mustahik. If you have 1,000 rand as zakat, how much can it help others? But if 1,000 rand and then there are 1,000 people contributing 1,000 rand, so you have 1 million rand, then you can do a lot of things. That's why the presence of amil institution is very important, and we should educate the people not to pay zakat directly to the mustahik, but to through institution of amil. But for infaq and sadaqah, yes, it's up to you whether you want to pay through institution or you want to pay directly. This is just one thinking that we should think about, and this is also one of the issues that we educate in the context of my country, in Indonesia. Because before 1999, people were of the view that it is better to pay zakat directly to the mustahik, because I know these people. But the question is, does your zakat able to help them in true sense, elevate them from the poor status, increase their living condition? The answer, most probably no. There is no impact, except it makes them more dependent upon the zakat payment that we do. So again, in this sense, we'd like to encourage the ummah to start establishing zakat institutions, strong, transparent, and accountable zakat institution. And that's why the presence of these principles is very important in our case. So this is just to respond for the last question. So I hope that we should not maintain this condition. I mean, you just let the people give directly zakat to the mustahik. No, we should not continue this one. We should educate the people to shift the way they fulfill their obligation. Because what we believe is Allah never mentions something without strong lesson. And this lesson that must be learned by us. And I think hopefully this will give answer to the last question. And then For the remaining ZCPs, I will explain the general meanings of the principle and then what should be in the case of Muslim minority country. Yeah, the fifth one, is about the supervisory techniques and tools. Yeah, so we need to have the appropriate range of techniques and tools to implement supervisory approach and employ Zakat supervisory resources which are subject to adequate validation and verification. So who will be conducting this supervision? Of course, in the essential criteria number 5, it is stated here that in the absence of national law regulating Zakat, the legal Islamic council or Islamic local community or other independent third party, yeah, may be used to assess the performance of Zakat institution in terms of financial and managerial accountability and Sharia compliance aspect. Yeah, so this is, I think, very important because being amil is not simple as that. I mean, sometimes people consider amil as the something which is easy. Being amil is not that easy. It has to be equipped with certain knowledge. It has to be equipped with certain supervisory tools and techniques, with the certain managerial principles, accountability principles, and if we look at, there are many hadith that can be made as the reference for us to have this good management. Yeah. So for this, we hope that the Islamic Council or Islamic local community or other independent third party may be used to assess the performance, yeah, of Zakat institution in terms of financial and managerial accountability and Sharia compliant aspect. Whether the distribution conducted by amil officer has been in line with the Sharia or not, has been complied with the Sharia or not. So far, we never do such an assessment. Yeah, what we do in many countries, including in Indonesia, what we do is based on the feeling. I feel that he has done his job. I feel that he has completed his duty to distribute Zakat according to the Sharia. But we never make a certain assessment which assure us that what has been done is basically complied with the Sharia principles. Yeah, so this is the thing that we want to be available in the operation of Zakat institutions. And then the sixth principle is about the supervisory reporting. Yeah, because reporting is very important. Yeah, and in the absence of national law regulating Zakat, Zakat institutions should comply with the internationally accepted reporting standard. Some of the reporting standard has been issued by the IOF. Yeah, IOF is an audit and accounting organization for Islamic financial institutions. It is based in Bahrain. Yeah, and some of the principles have been issued, and it can be downloaded online. Yeah. And then the seventh principle is related with the corrective and sanctioning power of Zakat supervisor. So this is this principle is basically discussing about the range of supervisory tools to bring about timely corrective actions. Yeah, corrective actions, the ability to revoke the license of Zakat and to recommend its revocation. Yeah, so. Actually, we try to see what kind of corrective sanction that can be applied. If, for example, an amil officer conduct mistakes, and a good institution that have good governance, they must have those corrective and sanctioning processes written in certain document, or it is written in the constitution of the Zakat institution. That's why in the fourth essential criteria, it is stated that in the absence of national law regulating Zakat, a set of appropriate supervisory procedure, including corrective action and sanction, should be clearly mentioned in the constitution of Zakat organization. So Of course, I believe that this may be less happen. I mean, in terms of number and the occurrence, yeah, maybe it is very less. But still, yeah, a good AMIL institution will have this corrective action, yeah, written in their constitution of the institution. And then the ZCP number 8 is related with the good AMIL governance, yeah, good AMIL governance, because good AMIL governance is very important, yeah, very important for us, yeah, that it will ensure the good conduct of zakat management, the good conduct of zakat management. And therefore, we need to have a strong AMIL governance in which we have policies and processes covering Sharia compliance. We have strategic tools, control environment, zakat management knowledge and responsibility of the zakat institution board, etc., as part of the governance aspect. And again, in the absence of national law regulating zakat, in the case of Muslim entry countries, yeah, principles of AMIL governance and its assessment, yeah, and the responsibilities of zakat institution boards, including succession process, should be explicitly and clearly mentioned in the constitution of zakat organization. And this will be the basis to do the governance aspect. So everything must be written in the constitution of zakat organization. And if something happens, what should be the mitigation process? What should be the action to solve, to overcome the problems? General principles must be mentioned clearly in the constitution of the institution. So this is, I think, very important, because the governance will ensure the quality of the management of zakat. Yeah. And then furthermore, on the principle number 9, we talk about the collection management, in which we need to have adequate policies and processes for nisab assessment and zakatable assets. And again, in the case of Muslim minority country, nisab assessment and formulation of sources of zakatable items should be conducted by a legal Islamic organization or authorized fatwa council. Yeah, I think this is also very important, because now we see the complexity of the economy. For example, I just give you the example of Indonesia. Yeah. There is a company. Yeah, this company has farm areas. Yeah, and also it has the processing factory. So the output from the farm areas, yeah, will be processed, and then it has certain businesses, yeah, in that one. So the question is how to determine, yeah, the calculation of zakat that must be paid by the company. Because in Indonesia, corporation must pay zakat under the corporate zakat, not only individual, yeah, but also the corporation. So corporate zakat. Given this complexity, you cannot simply say that, okay, let us follow the calculation of zakat on agriculture, yeah, because you have farming areas. Yeah, we cannot simply say. Why? Because the nature of the business conducted by this company is complex. It is not, you cannot say that this company is agriculture company. Yeah, simply because it has farm areas. Yeah, so what we do? Okay, for these farming areas, when you are having the harvest time, yeah, and then yes, calculation can follow the zakat of agriculture. But when you do the processing, manufacturing, the output of this, and then producing something new, and then this will come under the zakat of tijari, zakat on trade. So the certain calculation is made. And how it is reflected in the accounting system. Yeah, so there has to be some guidance on this one. And of course, yeah, you need to have the basic regulation on this issue, yeah, to tackle the issue of this company's zakat payment. Yeah, so that's why here in the collection management, you need to have also formulation of sources of zakatable items and nisab assessment, etc., which is done by the legal Islamic organization or authorized fatwa council in the absence of Zakat Act. Yeah, it is very important. So everyone, so it will also reduce the task of the amil officer. Instead of explaining everything, you just give them, this is the fatwa, this is the regulation, and this is how you calculate, and then let me calculate it for you if you are not able to calculate by yourself. Yeah, so that's why collection management here should be regulated, yeah, by the Islamic legal organization. And then furthermore, for the disbursement management, the idea of the ZCP number 10 is we need to have a standardized distribution system in which you can see several things that to us it is new things. And of course, when we discuss this to my colleagues in National Board of Zakat of Indonesia, he even asked me, wow, this is something which is very difficult for them. But this is how we have to go through. Yeah, why? Because here in the distribution, yeah, we have issued or we have made several essential criteria in which to some, including to our organization and also to Malaysia Zakat institutions, are considered new. For example, is on the allocation to collection ratio. We never have allocation to collection ratio. How much of the zakat is allocated compared to the collection? Because what do we mean by the allocation to collection ratio is the one that you distribute to the asnaf other than amil. Yeah, so you need to have the ratio 90% or above. It will be highly effective here. Yeah, if the allocation to collection ratio is equal to 90% or more, so it means that the way you allocate, the way you distribute is highly effective. Yeah, it means that the amil takes maximum 10% as their right. Yeah, this is highly effective. If it is between 70 to 89% is effective. Yeah, 50 to 69% fairly effective. 20 to 49% below expectation. Below 20% is ineffective, and the amil officers must be sleeping, because they distribute the fund below 20% of the collected fund, collected zakat. So if I'm the muzaki, I will see how much is the percentage of your allocation to collection ratio. If it is 85%, oh, it means you are doing a good thing. You are working well. Why? Because in one of the essential criteria, you have to distribute the zakat, yeah, for 1 year after the board or the institution approve the program. Yeah, so it means that if you collect zakat on, let's say, to make it easy, let us use the January to December calendar. Yeah, if you collect zakat on January 2014. And now is October 2015, and the collected zakat is not distributed, it means that you are not an amanah people. It means that you are not an amanah officer. Yeah, you are not a trustable institution. So we limit that one to maximum 1 year. Yeah, so this is in terms of the collection. Yeah, and of course it is based on the various dalil. Yeah, various dalil. So we come up with the conclusion that zakat, the nature of zakat, it has to be distributed as soon as possible. That's why if you look at the page, just hold on. If you look at the page, if you look at the page 14, yeah? The page 13 and 14, yeah, you can see the performance indicator there, yeah? That zakat distribution program can be divided into two. The first one is consumptive-based program. This program is designed to fulfill short-term needs of the mustahik. While for productive-based program is designed to empower the mustahik in the longer term, in the long term, so that they will be having sustainable sources of income, yeah, in so that they can be able to feed themselves. Yeah. And for the consumptive base means it does not require too many technical assistance. Yeah, but for productive base, of course, it requires technical assistance. Yeah. So for consumptive base program, yeah, the speed of disbursement, if an organization can distribute less than 3 months, it is called fast. Let's say the board meeting approved the program on February, and on April, the program has been conducted. So it means that the organization has an effective program and clear targets for consumptive-based program so that collected zakat may reach the recipients immediately. Because speed of distribution is very important in order to get the people's trust. Yeah. If it is between 3 to 6 months, it is classified as good. 6 to 9 months, it is fair. 9 to 12 months, it is considered as slow. But if it exceeds 12 months, extremely slow, and you need to replace the officer. Yeah, extremely slow. But for productive-based program, yeah, since it is more difficult, because, for example, productive-based is based on the hadith from Salim bin Abdullah, yeah, and it is reported by Imam Muslim that a person came, a companion came to the Prophet and asked for zakat, and the Prophet gave him the zakat, yeah, taken from the Baitul Mal, yeah, and then ask him to make it productive so that he will not beg for zakat anymore. So this gives us an indication that we also need to have the productive-based zakat programs, yeah, providing just like microfinance, yeah, providing financial resources for the mustahik to start up their business. Of course, the mustahik will need your technical assistance, how you start up the business and what kind of business that suitable for you, how to produce, how to sell, and where is the market. Yeah, that is the duty of the amil officer, yeah, to provide these things so that the productive-based zakat programs can be implemented in a very good way. Yeah, so this is the example of ZCP number 7, which talks about the disbursement management. So why we do this? Because we want to increase the quality of the governance, quality of the delivery of the program. Because sometimes, in many cases, zakat institutions focus only on muzaki side. They serve Muzaki perfectly. They provide Muzaki with the information. Your zakat has been received. This is the receive form, etc. But when it comes to the mustahik side, sometimes the way you serve the mustahik is not as excellent as the way you serve the muzaki. Yeah, this is something, should be corrected. Yeah, this is something not right. The way you serve both must be excellent. If you excellently serve the muzaki, then the same excellent service must be given also to the mustahik. Yeah, when you promise them to give scholarship on time, then make sure everything is delivered on time. This is one example. When you promise to the mustahik that you will conduct the technical assistance, yeah, every, let's say, this is just an example, yeah, first and third week of the month, then you have to deliver it on time according to your promise. This is showing the excellent service for the mustahik. And that's why the ZCP number 10 attempts to provide. Yeah, this is the longest ZCP, yeah, if we compare, because we want to see, yeah, we want to give good services to the mustahik. And ayah At-Tawbah verse number 60 comes first. Yeah, before At-Tawbah 103. Yeah, the first one deals with the distribution aspect, while the second one deals with the collection aspect. Yeah, so it means that distribution should be made as one important indicator determining the success or the failure of the program of zakat institution. That's why we need to have clear regulation, clear procedure and mechanism, clear assessment process, yeah, in the and in this essential criteria number 16, yeah, although it is in the absence of national law regulating zakat, yeah, this procedure, this mechanism, this assessment of zakat distribution should be regulated in the constitution of zakat organization. Yeah. So that's why by having this, we are trying also to implement this in the context of National Board of Zakat of Indonesia. Okay. So I asked them, okay, let us now calculate what is our allocation to collection ratio. Yeah. Yeah, if it is exceeding 80%, okay, it means you are doing a good job and you can have a bonus. So it means you work hard for that one. Yeah. But if it is less than, so it means I have to evaluate. Yeah, evaluate your position. Yeah. So you need something to evaluate. Yeah. For the internal management, it is also good. So you know the indicator. Indicator of a person doing a good job or not, doing a good distribution or not. Yeah, so I think this is something good. And then, I will stop. Any question or comments, or let us move. Let me complete first, or yeah, okay. And the next is about the country and transfer risk. Yeah, country and transfer risk. So. The next dimension is on risk management, as I mentioned to you. For your information, and hopefully this will be available. For your information, alhamdulillah, I myself has with my colleague, who is also my wife, we have constructed an index to measure the impact of zakat, yeah, on poverty and welfare level. And we have constructed four indices: index of welfare, index of spiritual poverty, index of material poverty, and index of absolute poverty. Yeah, this is out of the context of this one, and the paper is can be downloaded online. I can give the information to Brother Hussein or Brother Arif. Yeah, so hopefully maybe it is useful here. Yeah, so in this context, why we come up with the index, yeah, to measure, because normally when we talk about zakat distribution impact, we never calculate the impact on quantitative basis. Yeah, we never calculate it based on the quantitative basis. Yeah, that's why we try to quantify something. And of course, for the campaign of Zakat, this will be providing very powerful argument that why you need to pay Zakat through our institution. When we say we are able to reduce the poverty of mustahik by 15%, and you compare with the statement we are able to reduce the level of poverty of mustahik, stop, I'm the full stop, what is the taste? I mean the difference. The first statement will be more powerful than the second one. People will be more convinced when they know the exact reduction of poverty of the mustahik. Yeah, that's why in this regard, I have constructed the index, and it is very easy to use. And it is based on the typologies mentioned in the Quran. Quran, when talking about the ability of man to fulfill their needs, then Quran divides them into four categories. Yeah, the first one is those who are able to fulfill both material and spiritual needs. They are called of having hayatan tayyibah, as mentioned in the Quran Surah 16 An-Nahl, verse number 97. Yeah, this is called welfare condition. So when we talk about mustahik, spiritually, materially, they have to be, I mean, in a better condition. Yeah, you should not focus only on material aspect of the poor, but also spiritual aspect of the poor. That's why spiritual assistance and material assistance must be conducted in an integrated approach. Yeah, spiritual assistance means like a weekly discussion on religion, yeah, on ibadah, on various religion issues. The second typology is those who are able to fulfill material needs, to fulfill spiritual needs, but they are not able to fulfill material needs. We call it material poverty. Yeah, material deficiency, but spiritually rich. In the Quran, it is also mentioned. Yeah, like in the Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 155 and 156. Yeah, in this ayah, Allah says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوءِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. So wanaksi minal amwali wal anfus. So it means that some people may not be able to fulfill the material needs. So we construct the index called material poverty index. Yeah. And the third one is the opposite of the second one. Spiritually poor, materially rich. Yeah. This also been mentioned in the Suratul An'am, verse number 44. Yeah. In many ayah. Yeah, in this ayah Allah says, falamma nasu ma dzukiru bihi fatahna alaihim abwaba kulli syai'in hatta idza farihu bima utu akhadnahum baghtatan fa idzahum mublisun. Spiritually poor but materially rich. Yeah, and the fourth one is the spiritually and materially poor. They are called absolute poor. And in the Quran, it is also mentioned in Surah Taha, verse number 124. Yeah, waman arado an zikri, fa inna lahu ma insyatan donka, wa nahsyuruhu yaumal qiyamati a'ma. So these typologies inspire me to construct an index that can be used as the measurement standard to evaluate the impact of Zakat programs on our mustahik. Yeah. And then next is risk management. Yeah, we have identified several risks. The first one is country and transfer risk. Yeah, this is also very important. Yeah, because when a country is aligned with this principle, yeah, of course we can show the world that it will be the Zakat fund transferred to that country will be utilized, yeah, in accordance with the local law and also with the Sharia principles. Yeah. Okay. And in this ZCP number 11, yeah, what we need to have is we need to have adequate policies and processes to control country risk and transfer risk of zakat in their international zakat transfer activities. Yeah. And in the absence of zakat supervisor, such as in the case of Muslim entry country, yeah, the zakat supervisor, the legal Islamic council or whatever the organization that has been given the mandate, they can cooperate with foreign zakat organizations that already comply with the internationally accepted zakat management standard. So this is the essential criteria. And then in addition to this country and transfer risk, we also have reputation risk and lack of confidence. Yeah, lack of confidence. Okay, we also need to have a good zakat institution must also need to have adequate management framework to handle contagion, reputation, and lack of confidence risk. Yeah, lack of confidence risk. How to tackle this? And in the case of Indonesia, I'm now doing the research on identification of risks that may appear in the operation of zakat by taking the case of National Board of Zakat of Indonesia or Basnas. Yeah, and according to our research, we have identified 60 risks that must be mitigated. Yeah, in order to improve the governance and also to improve public confidence. Because improving public confidence is very crucial for us. Yeah, alhamdulillah, by continuous process, within 15 years, we can increase the collection 25 times. Yeah, in 2001, around $6 million to 350 million US dollar in 2014. Yeah. So within 13 years, but the number is simply because our population is also big. We have 237 million people and more than 200 million are Muslims. Yeah, so multiply if you multiply with hundreds of million, then the number will be very big. But if we compare with the total potential. The potential of zakat in our country is around 22 billion US dollar. So it means that it is still less than 2%. So what we need is not high growth of collection, but exponential growth of collection. Yeah, not only in a high rate, but it's very, very high rate. It should be like that to reduce the gap. So this is something that also we need to do. And therefore, I hope Sanzaf, yeah, or maybe some of academicians here, you should calculate the potential of zakat in South Africa. Yeah, the data that we have is only on OIC member countries. From the research done by Monzerkaf, we do the calculation, and we found, as I mentioned 2 nights ago, that the potential of zakat in the OIC member countries is reaching at least 600 billion US dollar per annum. Yeah, which unfortunately cannot be optimized until now, yeah, given this. So, but that excludes South Africa because South Africa is not OIC member country. So you need to do this because you need to know what is our potential actually, yeah, and what needs to be done in order to reach that potential. So that is for the ZCP number 12. So in this case, yeah, you need to have a clear regulation on the periodic report to the Muzaki. And I believe, yeah, I believe that you already have this one, that you need to periodically make report, yeah, to the Muzaki. And it should be clearly defined in the constitution of zakat organization. And in order to improve this confidence level, in the additional criteria number two, we encourage the Zakat institution to have appropriate information technology policies and processes to ease the periodic report to the Muzaki. That's why being amil is not easy. I mean, you need to have strong IT system that will ease the periodic report to the Muzaki that can be accessed by the relevant or related parties. Yeah. So I think this will be increasing the public confidence on you, on us. And then next, ZCP number 13 is related with the allocation risk. Allocation risk is also very important. Muzaki means donor, yeah? Muzaki donor, mustahik is the recipient, okay? allocation risk, it is also very important because it may give impact. Yeah? As I mentioned in the beginning of my presentation, misallocation will affect the recipient, of course, significantly. Yeah, and when it affects the recipients, the mustahik, then it may further degraded their living condition, which is not in line with the basic objective of Zakat. That's why we also need to analyze the risk that may appear on allocation side, on the distribution side. Yeah, so I think identification of this kind of risk is very important. And then when you are able to identify the risk that may appear, and then you need to have the mitigation actions, how to mitigate the risk that appears, and then you can find the solution. Yeah, so in this allocation risk principle, Zakat institutions should be able to mitigate allocation risks such as financial position sound and misallocation of distribution activities. Sometimes there is misallocation of distribution. Yeah, for example, given the same name of the recipient, yeah, but different, one of them is basically the donor. It should be, I mean, he should be the Muzaki. The other one is the true recipient, the mustahik. But since their name is same and we do not making any recheck, yeah, and then we send the fund to the first name, and what happened? Yeah, it is misallocation of fund. So it should not happen. Yeah, so that's why this risk is very important to be analyzed. And for the essential criteria, we have identified five essential criteria, and then you can see each. Hopefully it will help you also in increasing your governance on distribution. Yeah, like you need to have disbursement strategy. I think you already have this one: disbursement strategies, policies, and processes to identify, to assess, monitor, and manage disbursement risk. Yeah, and also we need to have comprehensive assessment for each ASNAF. What should be the criteria of ASNAF fakir, miskin, fi sabilillah, ibnu sabil in the context of South Africa, and also financial management. Yeah, you need to update the financial management so that the board can have accurate figure of financial position to meet all financial obligations timely. Because sometimes if you don't have the accurate figure of financial position, you are not able to meet all financial obligations timely, and you have to have this in detail. Yeah. And in the absence of national law regulating Zakat, mitigation procedure on the management of disbursement risk should be mentioned in the constitution of Zakat organization on and or in other internal regulation. I think this should bring us to the new, not new, actually to the better, yeah, management of Zakat when we have regulation to mitigate the risk of allocation. And then the next ZCP is on operational and Sharia compliant risk. Yeah, sometimes this also very important because it will affect, yeah, the delivery capacity, the capacity to deliver the program. Yeah, the capacity to deliver the program. That's why you need to have sound operational risk management, yeah, and Sharia compliant risk management. And yeah, and in the absence again for the essential criteria number 5, which is devoted for Muslim minority country, yeah, the presence of Sharia supervisory council or fatwa council is highly needed in order to ensure Sharia compliant aspect. Appointment procedure and operational mechanism of this council should be regulated in the constitution of Zakat organization. Yeah, in the practice of banking system, Islamic banking system, the presence of Sharia supervisory council is a must. You need to have Sharia supervisory council in each Islamic financial institution. Why? Because this council is responsible to ensure, to assure that you practice Islamic finance in accordance with the Sharia. And of course, some reports must also be made. Yeah, even in our case, yeah, we have put the presence of Sharia Supervisory Council in our Zakat Act. Yeah, because without without the right person, the Fiqh scholars that understand modern management in one hand and understand Fiqh of Zakat, of course, on the other hand, it is quite difficult for us to guarantee that what we do is has been in line with the Sharia. That's why the presence of this council is very important. And we have accommodated this in the case of Indonesia, we've accommodated this in our Zakat Act. And then the ZCP number 15 is on Sharia control and internal audit. Yeah, Sharia control in internal audit. Yeah, Sharia control and internal audit frameworks are very important. Yeah, in order to maintain a properly controlled operating environment in the light of Sharia. Yeah, in the practice, in the operation of Zakat management. Yeah, even for your information, we are now in the process of making Sharia audit. Yeah, our new national chairman, I heard that you are former auditor general, so you must be very familiar, yeah, with the audit. Yeah, but for Sharia audit, this may be something new. Yeah, because Sharia audit means you need to audit the organization according to the Sharia principles. And for your information, we are now in the process of establishing the Sharia audit principles, mechanism, and procedure, and also the outcome of the audit. The outcome of the audit. So far, this is still ongoing process, but let me give you one keywords, or several keywords that I give you keywords that when we talk about Sharia audit, we prepare 4 outcomes. First, in line with the Sharia, that is the outcome of the audit. The second one is a minor violation of the Sharia. The third one is major violation of the Sharia. And the fourth one, against the Sharia. So what should be the actions taken if, let's say, board, the director or the leaders of the Zakat organization, when we conduct the Sharia audit, the outcome is major violation. What should be the action if it is totally in line with the Sharia, it's not a problem. But if there is minor violation, what should be the mitigation? What should be the action? If it is major violation, what should be the action? And if it is against the Sharia, yeah, because it does not accommodate at all the Sharia principles, or it distribute according to his feeling, yeah, according to the feeling of the officer of Amil, so what will happen? What should be the actions taken? Yeah. So all of this require manageable Sharia audit, yeah, and this is also something new in the Islamic economics and financial world. You can say this is something new. Yeah, that's why we welcome you. Yeah, perhaps some of you are academicians. Yeah, please do some research on this. How you have the Sharia audit. Yeah, and when you report to the public that our organization is in line with the Sharia, you have certain evidence. Of course, we are not measuring the level of taqwa, it's different. Yeah, we just measure whether what we do is in line with the Sharia or not. We are not measuring the niyyah, the intangible aspect that cannot be measured. But of course, activities, report, documentation, programs, the beneficiaries, the recipients, yeah, we can evaluate them from the Sharia perspective. Whether the recipients are eligible to receive zakat or not, yeah, we can evaluate all of these aspects from the Sharia principle. And then the ZCP number 16 is related with the financial reporting and external audit. Yeah, I think I don't have to, this is something which is understandable and known to all of us, and I think we don't have any problem with this. Yeah, this is very important. All of us agree that we need to maintain reliable records of financial statements, of annual publication and external audit function. Yeah, and in the absence of national law regulating zakat, external audit and annual publication should comply with relevant regulation and internally should be regulated in the constitution of a zakat organization. So this is ZCP number 16. Yeah, and then for ZCP number 17, it is related with the disclosure and transparency. Yeah. So the zakat institution must regularly publish consolidated information that is easily accessible and fairly reflects their financial condition and performance. And all of these, yeah, must be regulated in the constitution or regulation of zakat organization. So you need to have transparent information on your activities, yeah, especially the financial activities. And the last one is the abuse of zakat services, yeah, because the abuse of zakat services may also take place everywhere. Yeah, if you look at, maybe if you look at 1,000 rand, you are not encouraged to abuse, misuse it. But if it is in your hand, 10 million, then the potential of misuse and abuse may happen. So what should be, yeah, what should be the response if this happens? Of course, inshallah, yeah, in many zakat institutions, this problem of abuse of zakat service is minimum, very, very minimum. Yeah. But again, in order to have good governance, yeah, we need to have appropriate policies and processes to promote Islamic ethics and professional standards and to prevent criminal activities. So everything must be, again, regulated clearly and must be defined clearly. Yeah, and it has to be better. It is written in the constitution of zakat organization, and local government may intervene. Yeah, when it comes to the issue of public fund, local government may intervene. Yeah, local government may intervene. So that is the whole idea of the Zakat core principles, 18 core principles, as an attempt to create an effective Zakat system. Yeah, this is just the, you can say, first document, because from these 18 principles, along with these essential and additional criteria, we in the team working group, yeah, we have identified at least we need to have more than 60, more than 60 documents, yeah, documents that translate this into the operational, that can be translated into the operation of Zakat institution. Yeah, so more than 60, you can imagine. Yeah, so a lot of things need to be done, but what we do is we believe that this document can help us in having better governance of Zakat, so that this potential, huge potential of Zakat fund, can be optimized. Yeah, can be realized, and it will be giving more benefit to the people's condition when it is managed in accordance with the modern principles. Yeah. So I think that's all about the Zakat core principles. Yeah. So if there's any comment or question, I would like to. I'm more than happy to answer. Okay. 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 Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Gee, sorry. Dr. Irfan will explain the Bank of Indonesia and Baznas, the Zakat government organization in Indonesia. He'll give us an overview of what they are about, inshallah.
In Indonesia, alhamdulillah, in 1999, after the reform era, we have Zakat Management Act number 38/1999, which becomes the new legal foundation. So if you look at the practice of Zakat in Indonesia before 1999, it was purely private matter. It was purely private matter, yeah. It was purely the responsibility of each mosque. So each mosque will be having Zakat committee, yeah. Even every asatiz, yeah, every ulama, yeah, has their own Zakat committee, yeah. And every organization, millions of organization, yeah, scattered in various parts of the country, yeah. So what happened? It gave no impact, no significant impact to the condition of the people. Yeah, to the condition of the people. So, but this happens for hundreds of years since Indonesia was under occupation of Dutch. Yeah, because Dutch, when they occupied us, they gave no room for Zakat. Yeah. Of course, under occupation. Even after we are independence, getting independence in 1945, still it becomes private matter. Yeah. So what happened? When there is the act, new act, attempting to regulate Zakat, you can imagine reluctancy of the people. Because for hundreds of years, Zakat was purely private matter. But we think, if we maintain this condition in the country, so how you can have a kafah Muslim? Yeah, we want to have kafah Muslim, yeah, kafah ummah that practice religion in a proper manner, following the tradition of the Prophet, following the sunnah of the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So alhamdulillah, after the 1999, we have the Zakat Management Act, and in 2001, the National Board of Zakat of Indonesia, or known as Basnas, Badan Amal Zakat Nasional, Basnas, was established, And in Indonesia, we accommodate also private zakat institutions that already established by the people. Yeah. So in Indonesia, there are two types of zakat institutions. The first one is government. The second one is private. Private means the institution that was established by people's initiative. So after a decade of operation, we need to change some regulation. So in 2011, we replaced the act with the new act, and it is Zakat Management Act number 23/2011. Yeah, in this new act, the Baznas, yeah, National Board of Zakat, is given more power to coordinate, yeah, all zakat institution operating in the country. But again, private zakat institution that was already established is also acknowledged. But of course, with the new act, we introduce certain standards that must be fulfilled. Because sometimes, I don't know here, but in Indonesia, some people, when they see potential of money there, they are willing to create zakat organization so that this money can be used under their hand. I mean, this is the tendency of the people there. Yeah. So what we do? Yeah. Not all of them are having good management. Yeah. On managing this money. So what we do then? We standardize the private zakat institution and give accreditation. Accreditation, yeah. So if the institution does not fulfill the requirement, it will not be accredited and it will be not allowed to collect zakat anymore. Because zakat is not, simple thing, and it's not something that something that we should seriously think about and manage. Yeah, we don't need those who are not seriously managing the fund. So accreditation. Yeah. So now, alhamdulillah, some of them have been accredited and continue to operate, but with condition they have to make report to National Board of Zakat. And if they don't give report, then we can take action. And alhamdulillah, in the new act, punishment to those who violate the regulation is worse than the previous act. Yes, in the previous act, you will face prison, jail, and also fine. Yeah, fine and jail are combined in the new act. Yeah, but again, it is still in the process of development. And I think that's all about the, yeah. Alhamdulillah, our beneficiaries or recipients reaching 3.8 million people, but still less than 20% of the total poor in Indonesia, which reach 30 million. Don't think about the figure because we are having 140 million, 30 million. So we are able only to manage 3.8 million people under our management. Yeah, we know in detail each of the recipient, 3.8 million. We know the data of them. We know the location. We know what kind of program that suitable for them. Yeah, I think Brother Arif has also visited some of our projects. Yeah, okay. Please, any questions? Yes. Waalaikumsalam warahmatullah.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Salman Khan. I just want to ask you a question on your earlier the presentation.
Yes.
That the movement of the funds internationally has been curtailed by the IMF and the World Bank, as well as the international bodies. The Zakat Fund is being seen as a transfer and as a like a tool for funding the terrorist organization. My suggestion would be that you have a very powerful group of 16 people as a working group on the, you know, the Zakat core principle, and you are meeting in a 6 months' time in, I think, for the IDB.
Yes.
Why not form a lobby group to do away with monitoring of the movement of the Zakat fund? Why I say so is, if you look at the disparity that you're saying that, you know, there is a 30 people eligible to be, you know, like to be looked after in Indonesia, there is a very good sound system of collection and the giving of the Zakat. There is a disparity. I mean, you look at the Qatar, there is no poor people, and they collect billions of the dollars.
Yes.
But then they cannot, unfortunately, transfer to the poor country like Mali and Somalia, Pakistan, Bangladesh, under the pretext of funding of the terrorism. So why we have to be monitor internationally our fund movement? Why, like the Ford Foundation, any other foundation, Christian foundation, they are free to transfer the fund, and they're empowering the Christianity across the board or across the world. Why, as a Muslim, we are not lobbying at the higher level? So that will be my humble, you know, submission that when you meet, maybe that should be a, you know, we have the power, we have the wealth, we are 1.6 billion people, one third of the, you know, the wealth is in our hand. So maybe that could be something to, you know, put onto the agenda and discuss, and maybe inshallah ta'ala we'll be able to have this implemented. Jazakallah khair.
Yeah. Actually, we have also your idea, we have submitted this also to the higher level of meeting, and why we need, why we don't make lobby, etc. Yeah, actually we do, but the problem is when they ask question like this, for example, are you sure that this Zakat is used for humanitarian purposes? Yes. What is the proof? How much in terms of the number of the recipients? What kind of a program? Do you have any standard of financial reporting system that can be accessed? Like in the banking system, you can access online, where the fund comes, where the fund goes. That is, this is the simple, and yes, we have, but is it standardized? The same like financial statement, is it understandable to all parties, or the points, items mentioned there? Yeah. So there are many issues. There are many issues. There are many issues. That's why, given this situation and what we do, on one hand, of course, political process is still going on, and we know that politically speaking, the Ummah is very weak. Yeah, but what we can do as part of the Ummah, we cannot rely only on the Minister of Foreign Affairs to discuss the issue. We need to do something as well. And one way to do that is by producing the core principles that can be verified and recognized by UN, for example, by IMF, by other multilateral institutions. Yeah. And of course, in order to reach that level, getting recognition from the multilateral institution, we need to have something in hand. That's why we come up with a document, and we come up with the plan of establishing Islamic Inclusive Financial Services Board as the dedicated multilateral institution. Yeah, and alhamdulillah, it has attracted major multilateral institutions in this world, like IMF, World Bank, and now in the upcoming World Working Group, the UN will also participate. So this is something that we also do. Yeah. So political side, let politicians do their part. Yeah. As the Zakat activists, we do our part. Yeah. So when we have standardized system, then we will say to the UN, why you still accuse us? You know you're getting involved in the process, you know the document, you know that that organization also aligned with this document. There should not be any question on them. Thank you. Yes?
Can I just
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
My name is Iqbal Kalia. If I may just add to the discussion, I think what we need, I also had the same question earlier and much of it is covered.
Yes.
To quote, one man's freedom fighter is another man's terrorist.
Yeah.
And I think we also need to challenge the financial intelligence centers of the USA.
Yes.
That when they can fund wars in Muslim countries, we must have a right to also fund defense. And I think we need to address these issues head on.
Yes.
Rather than pandering around to comply with the laws that they've created to control the flow of our funds, which need to be legitimately utilized in the context of Sharia requirements.
Yeah.
And that means war for that matter.
Yeah.
So thank you for that. What I need to raise with you, brother, is you mentioned the maximum 10% for the Amir.
No. This is for the highly effective, yeah.
Yeah, but okay, you are giving an example. What is your view? If in terms of the Ashnaf, that an allocation of funds to the Amil, or in my thoughts, an office of Amil, that 12.5% of the funding is allocated to that.
Yeah.
And then on the issue that you talk of risk management, and you gave the example of bursaries, and you also talked about a distribution needs to be done within the 1 year.
Okay. Yeah.
How would you overcome, for example, if I may use the bursary example, someone needs a bursary for 5 years.
Yeah.
And if your distribution requirement is 1 year, how would one overcome that?
Thank you very much. And yes, of course, we have the right to defend ourselves. Yeah. And I agree with you. I totally agree with you. And although, in fact, we are still in the very weak position at the moment. But the idea of Zakat core principles is not only on facing the Western superiority. No, it's not only that. But it is also designed to increase the quality of management of our Muslim ummah. Yeah, this is also one of the idea. Yeah, you can imagine if we can have Zakat Act in all 57 member countries, maybe the rahmah from Allah will come to us. Yeah, maybe what happened today because we neglect one of the obligatory worship. Yeah, because ibadah is divided into two. The one that is Dayani does not require any legal foundation. But the one that is classified under Qadoi, it has to be regulated. It has to be supported by certain rules and regulation, like the presence of Zakat Act. So this is the idea. That's why I agree with you. Yeah, and this Zakat core principles is part of our process to strengthen our ummah. And for the distribution, 1 year means that the fund that you collect now must be distributed less than 1 year. But if one case, the mustahik needs 2 years, for example, after this, yes, no problem. But the delivery should take place before 1 year, which means that if you collect Zakat on August 2014, then on October 2015, it is still not distributed. It means that the Amil is not working. So you have to replace the Amil. That is the idea. Yeah. And as for the Amil's right, we follow the contemporary fatwa of the ulama of Sheikh Wahbah Az-Zuhayli Rahimahullah, Yusuf Qardawi, and others, many others to be mentioned. That maximum for the Amil's right is 1/8, 1/8 or 12.5%. You can see in the ZCP number 8 in the essential criteria number 1, in the page 29, that maximum is 1/8. In case this is not sufficient, you can take other sources. infaq and sadaqah with the approval of Islamic Council. So in our case, with the approval of Sharia Supervisory Council in Islamic countries, yeah. So I mean, you cannot simply like say like this. Since infaq is very flexible, we can use it according to our wish. You cannot simply say, if you want to use infaq, yeah, to support the operational costs of the institution, then it has to get approval, yeah, from the Sharia scholars, which allows you to use that fund for the operational costs, yeah, to fund your operational costs, yeah. That's what we are talking about. Yeah. Okay. Any other question? Yes. Yeah. Yes, he's first and then after. Yeah.
I think currently as we're sitting here, our planet is facing huge changes, right? One of those changes are environmental. I think the planet that we know now versus 50 years from now would change considerably. Now, one of the items on environmental on the environmental agenda is the increase in the temperature, right?
Temperature, okay.
Which will go up a degree or two, and that will invariably affect many things. One of the things are agriculture, which effectively will affect our food supply, which effectively, at the end of the day, will affect the poorest of the poor. Now, having said that, my question to you is, surely one of the core principles should encompass or should imbibe environmental or eco-justice of sorts, right? Because as a community, we cannot carry on with the existing practices as we have, given the grave danger that our planet faces.
Okay.
So I think the core principles of espousing at least some form of environmental or eco-justice within those principles actually becomes crucial, because at the rate things are going, it will actually create a greater burden on beneficiaries of Zakah, and hence an obligation on Zakah institutions.
Yeah, thank you very much. We will accommodate this, and in the next working group, we will try to discuss. But as long as our concern, when we talk about the recipients of beneficiaries, it is based on the individual. As for the efforts for environmental issues, yeah, I'll give you an example in my country. What we do, there is a sadaqah on trees. Sadaqah on trees. Jadi, so a person may pay sadaqah, yeah, in the form of tree, and this tree will be planted in certain areas. But unfortunately, it is burned now. Yeah, I mean, this can be also part of the our agenda. Yeah, to deal with the issue of environmental degradation. Yeah, but yes, you can accommodate that one. But of course, for the zakat, yeah, of course, it may be coming under asna fi sabilillah. It may be, but to us, I think we should utilize other sources of fund, that is infaq and sadaqah. But for zakat, let us focus on individual, yeah, on the person, on those who are eligible to be classified in one of the 8 asnaf. Yeah. So this is what we do in this document. But you can put it, as I mentioned here in the core principles of zakat disbursement, you can put that the beneficiaries may be in the form of a program that is related with the environmental condition. But to me, my personal view, the recipients should not be in the form of trees or etc., but the recipients at the end of the day should be on individual. Yeah, but we have infaq, sadaqah, we have waqaf, that can be used in that development, yeah, in the implementations. Yes, yeah.
I'm coming back to this financing terrorism.
Yes.
Terrorism, we know, is subjective.
Yes.
And we know that those that may be classified as a terrorist, justly, justifiably or not, may be in need of zakat. I have a sense, and I hope I'm wrong, that we are saying that for the greater good of those others that may need zakat, we are willing to sacrifice the zakat, which may be due to those that are classified as terrorism.
Yes, I agree with you that we should not follow the definition of terrorism, yeah, that is given by the Western government, yeah, because we know if we discuss this political issue, I think all of you must be more experienced than me, yeah, no more than me. But the idea is we are facing the true fact that we cannot easily transfer the zakat fund, that's it. Whatever the idea behind that one, yeah, anti-money laundering, anti-terrorism is just the issue. But the basic fact is, it's not easy to transfer zakat through banking and financial system. It's not easy. That's why you need to carry on with your hand. You need to send representative with your own. And how much is the cost to send a person? Yeah, let's say if you want to have program in Gaza, you cannot transfer the fund through financial system. Why? Because the fund will never come there. So what we need to do? Let what has been done, you do whatever you do. Yeah. But the basic idea is how we then overcome the problem and the presence of core principles, just like Basel core principles, that can be identified and recognized. It's very important because at least it may reduce the problem. Yeah. It may reduce the problem. And it will also help the government of OIC countries, which are rich countries, to identify the right recipient in other country because there are lack of information. Sometimes, like in Kuwait, for example, if you look at their report, yeah, more than 80% of the fund is transferred to abroad, I mean to other countries. Most of the programs of distribution of zakat in Kuwait is conducted in other countries. But of course, the effort they use is very, very huge, yeah, and the resources used also very huge. And when we have certain principles that is internationally accepted and recognized, then it will ease the authorities to review the candidate of recipients. If they are complying with the principles, they will automatically know that these recipients candidate, I'm talking about the organization, yeah, candidate of the recipient, yeah, this organization has fulfilled the criteria, and I know it means that they are trustable, they're manageable, because in these principles it is required that you have to distribute within less than a year. It means that you do not accumulate your wealth and take the interest, yeah, keeping it in the bank, and the more, the longer you keep in the bank's account, yeah, the more interest you get. So they will not do that. They will immediately distribute the fund to the recipients. One more question? Yes, the last one.
One of the elements that you mentioned in terms of the performance measures, right? You said that the quick disbursement of the
yes,
as well as the effective, obviously,
yes,
disbursement. So now I would think this would require a lot of manpower for the organizations that are distributing the zakah on the ground, for example, the ears and the eyes of, so that the zakah can go to the correct individuals, right?
Yeah.
So that would mean that the organization would have to employ more people and pay them. So doesn't this aspect take us back to where the zakah is more being used to pay employees or people who are making sure that the zakah is dispersed properly?
Yeah.
As opposed to a muzaki giving it directly. So how do you encounter this type of a problem?
Yeah. Quick distribution does not necessarily mean that you need more manpower. It requires strategic management, proper management of of collection and distribution. How you collect, how you distribute, you need to have sound policies, good policies, effective policies. Yeah. Manpower, I mean, it depends on the condition. It does not necessarily associated with the quick disbursement, no. If you have a lot of manpower, but you don't have strategic planning of distribution, then it will not meet the objective as well. So this is not related with the manpower. This is related with the proper management of distribution. It means that if, let's say, you decide that, okay, we receive this and we do some meeting and we agree to execute the program, and then the program is delivered within 2 weeks after your meeting, it means that you are prepared. You are well managed. You know what to do. Yeah. So this is the idea of giving the criteria of quick disbursement, fast, effective, etc., and also allocation to collection ratio. Because in the UK, for example, one of the reputable charity organization, if you look at their cost structure, they take only 4%, yeah, of the total donation. You can imagine. Because the more you have money, of course, the percentage can be reduced. The percentage can be lowered. Yeah, although the absolute amount may increase. Yeah, 12.5% from 10 million rand, yeah, with 2% from 1 trillion rand, of course, 2% of 1 trillion rand is bigger than 12.5% of 10 million rand. So the percentage may be reduced. So what does it mean? It means that they can effectively, yeah, manage the zakat fund. So that is the idea, yeah, of this principle. That's all, I think. Okay, so thank you very much for your kind attention. Hopefully what I'm trying to what I was trying to present can benefit all of us. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakallah khair. We'd like to thank Dr. Irfan for taking his time out to share his knowledge and expertise. And we hope, inshallah, that once the ZCP document is complete, he can return next year to share more of his knowledge and expertise. I now hand over to Hussein to conclude this session.
Shukran jazilan. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Okay, so I think it was an altogether positive session that we had. And of course, the document itself, just over 40 pages, we would not have done justice within the time limitations that we had. But the idea was two. One was to introduce to you the concept of a standard that we want to aspire towards. And at the very least, when you go back home, you have some level of knowledge about what we want to try and do with this. I know for a fact that when we started this off initially, there were a lot of people that were potentially opposed to this. Who are you? Where are you from that you want to do this? And people have had vested interests, like is normal. That, you know, we've already been doing this, you know, you are only 21 years old, we've been doing it for 40 years, we are doing it for 60 years, we have an authority in our country. And so the idea of a standardization of this Zakat Core Principles, as we're defining it, is firstly an aspirational document. But inshallah, when we get there, like all journeys, when we arrive, we will then understand and appreciate how much better we are at compared to where we started. And that goes for any journey for that matter. I think Sensef in itself has been going through that journey for the last number of years. And I think it's about managing change. So what we were attempting to do today is firstly give you a hint of the potential that exists in this, number one. Number two is to begin the process of change management so that when it comes to you eventually, inshallah, it's easier for you to adapt and adopt for implementation. What is clear for now is that this is very likely to become a standard within the OIC countries. Because once it goes through the rigors of the IDB and within the Sharia boards, I think the intention at May 2016 is to introduce it to the finance ministers, and they will probably either ratify or adopt it as law in their own countries. But there's no reason why Muslims who find themselves in minority communities, and I can think of one very big minority community, India. India is a minority community with this population of about approximately 16 to 20%. There's no reason why it can't be adapted and adopted in that country as well. But equally, there's no reason why in South Africa we can't look at those that are achievable in our case to say we're going to adapt and adopt so that we begin to aspire towards the highest standards of a zakat regulation. It can only be good for us in the total picture of things. I want to maybe just make a comment. Sometimes, you know, we clutter, we pick on the one thing, and so the theme for this morning somehow landed up on the war against terrorism. I don't think necessarily that this was firstly the space to have raised it. I appreciate in what context it was raised. But certainly when we, can I use the word we? When we started this whole process of the Zakah Core Principles, that was probably furthest from our mind. We don't want to regulate how you transfer money between yourselves and what. That's not necessarily the main aim of this. The main aim of this principle is how do we become better at what we're doing so that when we eventually need to do what we need to do freely, we've got a leg to stand on, and in this case, two legs to stand on. And so the aspirational objective is achieve it so that we can defend our position as equally as anyone else out there can defend their position. Shukran jazilan.